kingdom of heaven is like a treasure buried in a field which a person finds and hides again. And out of joy goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. When he finds a pearl of great price, he goes and sells all that he has and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea, which collects fish of every kind. When it is full, they haul it ashore, and sit down and put what is good into buckets. What is bad, they throw away. Thus it will be at the end of the age. The angels will go out and separate the wicked from the righteous, and throw them into the fiery furnace, where they will be wailing and grinding their teeth. Do you understand all these things? They answered, yes. And he replied that every scribe who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household who brings from his storeroom both the new and the old. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Not that I need encouragement in this regard, but somebody suggested that if I didn't like the heat this week, I'd better get working on going to heaven, because the other place is pretty hot. Summer's a time when I get to go out and visit the home. I love that. It's just kind of, life can be so busy, it's really difficult to do that type of cool ministry. And so I get to go see people who are living in homes they built like 60 years ago, or people who just moved to town to be with their family. I've seen people in assisted living or nursing homes. I see somebody who's in his 60s. He's a disabled man. He has not been able to come to church for a while. And I see Lena Petrocelli's our oldest person. She's 102. She'll turn 103 this December. And she's still writing poetry, and she's still full of stories, and she's still quite the wit. And in all those varieties, in all those little visits, there's usually two constants. One is the gallery of stars, I call it, that set of family portraits. And you know, you can talk about all sorts of stuff, and then you say, well, who's in the picture? And their world brightens up. My favorite was this lady I just saw last week, and she said, you want to come into the bridal suite? They got every essence in the bridal suite. And what the bridal suit is that the bedroom is full of all the marriage pictures going back to her, I think it's even her grandparents, but definitely her parents and herself and all her kids and all her grandchildren. And there's just wedding pictures everywhere. She's so proud of her. It's kind of important. I think the family should be a treasure in our lives. Our family should be beloved. We should be devoted to them. They take such an important place. The other thing that's so consistent in that generation is that prayer corner, or that prayer book, or those rosary beads. They have a place where they watch Oprah, and then they have that like rosary beads that look like they've been used thousands upon thousands of times. Because God is treasure in their lives. God's such a center of their lives. I meet people who barely can be coherent, and they say, let's say a prayer in the name of the, and they just jump right into it. Such a key moment, a key part of who they are. I thought of that as I read those parables that Jesus gives to the people. Because God really is a treasure. He really is that pearl beyond price. And it will take sacrifice and devotion, it will take care and effort to make him the center and keep him the center of our lives. The cool thing is that if he's the center of our lives, he draws others into that center. He gives us the grace from that center to reach out to others, especially our families, even the heart problems of our families. But I think there's a concern going through the church. It's kind of unspoken in a certain way. It's kind of like global warming. Remember, you know, 10 years ago, I was a biochemist by training, you'd hear these scientists talking about this thing, and you'd be like, what are you talking about? They knew about it before it really started hitting us. And this isn't just an academic concern, I think, that that's coming to the church. Because we had read in that first reading about separating, you know, actually the gospel, about separating the good fish from the bad fish, and there is a fiery furnace involved in this decision. And the concern is the future of the church, in particular the faith of the next generation. Will it be deep enough? Will it be abiding enough? Will it be strong enough to get them through the struggles that are ahead? And I kind of share that concern. I'm kind of preaching to the choir here. We're here all the time. But think about the others who are part of our parish who say, well, I'm a Catholic. But are they really taking Jesus as the treasure, as that pearl beyond price? Or if, like, maybe soccer is just about as important, or maybe, you know, I kind of had a long night last night and my sleep is just as important. Is sacrifice, is devotion part of their faith life? I'm concerned, but I'm not really fearful. And really, in the end, God is God. He's going to reveal the treasure that He is. I do pray that as people experience that treasure, that they're willing to go through the sacrifice, they're willing to take upon themselves the effort to purchase that pearl beyond price, to dig up that treasure in the field. Because He's definitely worth it. He's been worth it in my life for years upon years. And this homily isn't really a place to kind of lay out the program by which we're going to re-evangelize our people. We're going to kind of put before them this truth that Jesus reveals in the parables. As a matter of fact, I think that it's going to come from the ground up. Any program that I'm going to reveal, well, I've been around the block a few times. But you're in the trenches. You know what it's like to try to talk to a kid that really hasn't gone to church before, about what the insight into trying to put before them the new evangelization. But I know it starts here. I know I'm not just preaching to the choir and to a truth that you kind of go, okay, whatever. I think you know the pearl beyond price. I know, or I think, that you put them as the center of your devotion, as the cornerstone of your spiritual life. He's worth it. All the sacrifices, all the care, all the concern, all the effort. Because in the end, nothing's more precious. And when we convert ourselves in this belief, when we deepen ourselves in this truth, then the grace flows through us. In the end, He is the cause of our hope. He is that assurance when I get a little nervous about where things are going. It's God who is that pearl. It's God who is that treasure. And I think we understand that. So let us be like good heads of households, pulling from the old and the new to bring grace and love and peace and a treasure to our world.